Hello, my name's Philippa Hoskin. I look after the medieval books at Corpus Christi College in Cambridge, and today I'm going to tell you about one of them, the Peterborough Bestiary.
Lots of the images that you see in the cartoon, in the film, about King Oswald's raven are actually based on pictures in a book from the 14th century, so written very soon after 1300, that used to belong to Peterborough Abbey. And that book is what we call a bestiary. Now, what's a bestiary? Well, sort of what it sounds like. It's a book of beasts. It's all about animals. And a bestiary is a sort of book that has lots and lots of information about different animals. Some of them real animals, some of them animals that are completely imaginary, fantasy animals. It could have had hundreds of small pictures and information about those beasts and how they were meant to live, where their names came from, what they did in them. The Peterborough Bestiary has over 100 pictures in it. It's got pictures of the elephant, who carries a whole castle on his back with people in it, of the camel being loaded up with a heavy load by men, of the cat and the mouse that it's meant to chase, of antelopes getting their antlers caught in trees and so the hunters can come and get them. It's also got pictures of much more fabulous and imaginary animals and beasts. There are pictures of unicorns in there. There's the mermaid who's singing sweetly, and her sweet singing is what's attracting a boat of sailors, we can see, and because they're going to be lured by her onto the rocks, we know that very soon their boat's going to crash and that is going to sink, and they're going to drown with it. It's also got beasts that you wouldn't have heard of, probably, like the amphibina. Now, the amphibina is a sort of serpent, we're told. It's got eyes, the bestiary says, that shine like lanterns. And it's got more eyes than most, because it's got two heads. One of them is where you'd expect to find a head. The other one is actually in its tail. So the bestiary says if it's frightened, if it starts running, the amphibian has to be really careful about it doesn't go in two directions at once, both of its heads trying to set off in another way. We can find the information that the bestiaries give us quite strange today. Why does it include so many strange and mythical beasts? Why has it got griffins and salamanders and unicorns and mermaids? Did medieval men and women really believe that those were real things? We look at the information it tells us about the animals and we think, well, that isn't true. That isn't how they behave. Tigers aren't so fascinated by their images in mirrors that hunters can use mirrors to catch them. And the animals don't always look like the pictures that were shown either. I mean, the tiger in the bestiary from Peterborough hasn't got any stripes, for example. It looks a bit more like a dog, really. And the crocodile, well, it looks nothing like a crocodile. And the bestiary says that its name comes from Cocceus, which is the Latin for yellow, because it says that's what colour it is. And yet the Peterborough Bestiary's crocodile, it really is, it's yellow. In fact, it looks a bit more like a lion as it opens its jaws really wide to take a man's head in. But medieval men and women weren't really thinking of bestiaries like that. They weren't bothered by that sort of thing, because a bestiary is a book of beasts, it's a book about animals, but it's not a guidebook to animals. No one would have taken a bestiary out with them on a walk to see if they could recognise animals or have looked at the cat or the mouse they passed and thought they'd know exactly what they were going to do because of what they'd read. And if they'd gone further afield abroad, they wouldn't have expected to recognise tigers or crocodiles because of what they'd seen in a bestiary. In fact, they thought of bestiary not as natural history, they thought of it as a religious book. A book about religion, a sort of spiritual book for them. That's why so many of them are owned by monks and nuns, like the monks of Peterborough Abbey. holy men and women who choose to live together, a sort of life of prayer. Because what they thought that Bestiary was for was to make you think. As well as telling you what an animal is meant to do in its day-to-day life, the Bestiary tells you something else and encourages the people who are reading it, or encouraged the people who are reading it, to look at a particular animal, to think about it, and to think about how it applied to them and what they could learn from it. So there's a sort of moral lesson, if you like, that you're given in the Bestiary. To give you an example, when it talks about the mermaid, and you're told about the mermaid and its sweet singing, luring men to their deaths on the rocks, you're then told, well, sin is a bit like a mermaid, isn't it? Think about sin as something very sweet and attractive, but you have to be careful, because if you follow it, if you go with it and you're lured along with it, then you're going to end up crashing, really. You're going to end up sinking in all sorts of ways. And it can also give you good ideas, ideas about the way you should live. So there are the bees, for example. The Bestiary tells you about bees working hard and working together. And then it says, well, maybe that's like us, or maybe we should be like that. If we want to make something sweet and good like honey, we've got to work hard, and we might have to work together as a community. So that's what a Bestiary is used as. And it shouldn't be a surprise to us then that most Bestiaries actually come from religious houses like Peterborough Abbey, and they're often found in books with other religious books. The Bestiary at Peterborough is bound up with a set of psalms from the Bible. So songs, holy songs if you like, or prayers that you would have found in Bibles too. The Bestiary probably also had another purpose, and this is why some of them were still made for individuals. They were a way of learning to read Latin. Sort of first book, if you like, for reading, but for Latin. And when we think about the pictures of all these interesting animals, and the pictures in the Peterborough Bestiary are very beautiful, there's lots of gold, lots of bright colours. And when we think about the exciting and surprising things that the book would have told you, we can see why that would work. We can imagine people wanting to learn more, wanting to keep reading, wanting to turn the page and see the next set of animals, and read more about animals that maybe they didn't know anything about, or that were familiar to them and they wanted to come back to. So Bestiaries are all about people learning all sorts of new and wonderful things, but thinking about and using pictures and ideas of animals in new ways. And the story of St. Oswald's raven that you've been looking at is another way of using those pictures from the Bestiary.